All right, what a great topic. Are y'all excited about the opportunity to discover who the Holy Spirit is? I certainly hope so. Before we go any further, I just want to say good morning. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Midtown. Great to have you with us, as well as everyone who's streaming on Facebook Live or however you are connecting with us. You are going to be changed by the end of this message. And why is that? Because you are about to discover the most important relationship on the earth. And it's with the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. And I want you to pray with me. Don't just sit there. Jump into this prayer. Because it's going to be simple, but it's super important. Lord, we want more of you. We want more of you. We are convinced that you want more of us. And we know that you are brilliant, and you know the only way you can get more of us is to give us more of you. So we're hungry this morning, and what we want, this world cannot give, but you give it to us. And we thank you that this morning we are all in, we're listening. We're hungry and we're thirsty because we're tired of nonsense and we want truth. We don't want to be lagging in our zeal. We want to know you more, and we're pressing in this morning to receive everything that you have to say to us by your Spirit. In Jesus' name. And if you agree that, you better say amen. Because amen means I believe. It's not just the nice thing we say at the end of the prayer. I believe. So I want to take you back in time. I want to take you back with the disciples at a very important moment. It's the Last Supper. In fact, you've got three chapters that John has dedicated to this time. John 14, 15, and 16. Super important chapters. Because Jesus is now disclosing to them what's going to happen to him, what's going to happen to them. He talks about what was to come and who was to come. He lays out some alarming things, and then he says some amazing things. And one of the things he says that's so important is, hey, I'm going away, but don't worry, I'm sending someone else. Now, can you imagine how those words hit the disciples? I mean, imagine that. You've been hanging out with Jesus for maybe close to 3 years. You want to be around Jesus. He's amazing. You've watched him perform miracles, and now he says he's leaving? It's amazing to me that none of the disciples argued, especially Peter. You think Peter would have said, Jesus, no, that's not a good idea. But I think maybe he learned not to do that. But their hearts, I mean, no, you can't go, you can't go. But he says this to me, I'm going away, but don't worry. I'm sending someone else. And then he goes on to say, it's best that I go away, because if I don't, the helper won't come. Now, if you read through different translations, the helper is talked about. Sometimes he's called the advocate, the comforter, the Holy Spirit, but it's all the same person, the Holy Spirit. And it's interesting that everyone right now, those of you in Midtown, those of you here, those of you streaming, every single one of us has a different understanding of who the Holy Spirit is. And your reaction might be mixed right now. Some of you are really elated that we're talking about the Holy Spirit. And some of you are a little like, I don't know about this. And that's okay. But I want you to think about this, because Jesus said it was going to be better. You see, it's interesting to me that right now in the church, the one who was sent to help us is the topic of great controversy. Either that, or he's not talked about at all. He's kind of like that cousin in the family nobody wants to talk about. He's kind of the best kept secret. I know he was for me. I grew up in the church and I didn't hear about the Holy Spirit. He got the honorable mention a few times, But nowhere, at no time, did anybody tell me how amazing the Holy Spirit was and what he was sent to do, and he was here to help me. I missed out on that, and I don't want you to miss out on that. He's all through the Bible. In fact, on the first page of the Bible, the Holy Spirit is there. It's when everything started to happen, when the Holy Spirit hovered over the waters. Bam, creation comes into play. He's on the last page of the Bible, where it says the Spirit and the bride say, come. And he's all through the Bible, in between. He's in the Old Testament. He's the one that helped Joseph interpret Pharaoh's dreams. He's the one that helped Elijah defeat all of those prophets of Baal. He's the one that came into John the Baptist when John the Baptist was an infant, a babe in the womb. And the Bible says he was filled with the Spirit and he leapt in his mother's womb. Don't you tell me that babies in the womb are not living beings. Interesting, the first one who knows who Jesus is an unborn child. Yeah, you write that down. You need to remember that. But he's there. When Jesus is baptized, the Holy Spirit shows up. And it says he descended on Jesus like a dove. Okay, we need to stop right here. Because if you're like me, we grew up coloring pages. In school, in church, and whenever you got the page that had the picture of the Holy Spirit on it, he was always a what? See, everybody said the same thing. He's not a bird. He's a person. It said he descended like a dove. You see, the Holy Spirit is no more a dove than Jesus is a lamb. Okay? Are we clear? Okay, good. We can move forward. Jesus' words said, when he comes, it will be better. And you know what? He proved it. On the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came in. The Holy Spirit came on the scene. He came as a rushing, mighty wind, and he descended on the disciples as flames of fire. Talk about somebody who knows how to show up and get a party started. That's how he came. I'm here. And on that day, in one day, the church is born. Thousands of people are saved. And the world is turned upside down. And the cool thing is that same Holy Spirit, with that same power, who showed up on the day of Pentecost, is here now. He's here now for the church. Jesus said it would be better. But the problem is, right now, for everybody, that's not the case. It's not better for everybody. Why is that? I'll tell you exactly why. I'll tell you why he's not talked about. I'll tell you why he's controversial. You see, when he showed up, Satan saw the results of his coming. He knows the Holy Spirit is his biggest threat. And he knew he couldn't eliminate him. He couldn't make him leave. So if you're Satan, you have a powerful enemy, what are you going to do? You see, the Holy Spirit is sent to be our helper. And that means the Holy Spirit needs mankind to help do the will of God. So if you can't do anything about the Holy Spirit, you work on humanity. You cut off that relationship by hindering the cooperation. So Satan started a media campaign on the Holy Spirit. He got into the minds of religious leaders, and even people still say this today. The gifts are not for today. The gifts are not for today. Or you get people freaked out over one aspect of the Holy Spirit, tongues. You get the church to avoid discussing him at all. That's what you do. So chances are, like me, you grew up in a church, didn't talk about him. So no wonder you have reservations. Or, better yet, you had a weird person introduce you to the Holy Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit is not weird, but people sure are. Let me tell you about my first encounter with the Holy Spirit. Now, I grew up as a Catholic, and like I said, we didn't talk about the Holy Spirit. But one day, I am with a former boyfriend, don't worry, Dennis knows about him. We're sitting in church. I'm in this little bitty Pentecostal church in South Georgia. Need I say any more? And I'm sitting there, and the preacher's preaching, and that's okay. Everything was fine. And then at the end, he asked for people that needed healing to come up. And this one person came up, and standing there, I'm thinking, what's going on here? This is a little weird. And then several people came around this person, and they begin yelling in tongues, and everybody is saying all this stuff, and I don't know what's going on, and I am freaking out. I look at my boyfriend, and he goes, he was no help. My heart is beating out of my chest. I'm like, oh, this is weird. This isn't God. This is weird. And I look at his mom, and she's like, and I'm thinking, I can't get out of here. I can't get out of here. I was freaking out. But later on, I would have a different encounter with the Holy Spirit. And I would come to know him for who he is. And I would pray in tongues. And here's what the Lord told me. He reminded me of that day. And he said, Colleen, remember that day and you had that encounter? He said, part of it was you were freaked out by the weirdness, but part of your problem, the reason you were so frightened, was because you were under the guise of a religious spirit. You see, religious spirits hate the Holy Spirit. Religious spirits will always tell you the Holy Spirit is someone to be feared. Now, granted, when you pray in tongues, there is no need to yell. Because when you pray in tongues, you're praying to Jesus. We don't yell at Jesus. That'll help some of you. Go ahead and post it. Somebody needs to hear this. The one who's sent to be the greatest help does not need to be the greatest controversy. You know, it's kind of like Sears. Several years ago, they came out with this ad campaign that was called Come See the Softer Side of Sears. You see, what happened was Sears always sold lots of things. They sold tires and tractors and tools, but they also sold clothing and kitchen items and appliances. But they became known for one thing. Sears is a place you go for tools. And so people were not purchasing the inventory. And so they had to remind people, Sears is not just about tires, although when you do go into Sears to shop, you do come out smelling like a tire, but anyway, can I tell you, the Holy Spirit is not just about tongues. There's so much more to him that you have yet to know, so I want you to come see the personal side of the Holy Spirit this morning. I want you to know my best friend. Because that's what he is. I don't want you to know someone else's misrepresentation of him. So put aside your concerns, put aside your fears, and let's view him from a very safe place. You're in a safe place, and we're going to view him through the lens of Scripture. The Holy Spirit is supernatural, but he's not scary. We have this fascination with the wrong side of the supernatural. You know, I was watching that football game last week. I know, I'm sorry to remind you of it. Some of you need to stop wearing black and get out of your mourning. But I don't know about you, but I noticed how many programs, new programming, new episodes, new this and that were being introduced, and how much of it had to do with supernatural things, only the dark side. So how is it that we are a people who are fascinated with the dark side of the supernatural, and we ignore the one who truly is supernatural. Yes. The one who showed up on this earth like a rushing mighty wind and fire. Why are we not curious about him? Because we've been deceived. Because we've been deceived. Many people know Jesus. I love Jesus. I want to know Jesus, but they don't know the Holy Spirit. But he came highly recommended by Jesus. And you're going to find out that he is the most important relationship. So let's go back to what Jesus said about him. Let's open up the Bible. Let's look at John 14 and what Jesus said in verse 16. He said, I'm going to pray the Father and he will give you another helper that he may abide with you forever. He is here forever. He will not leave you or forsake you. And he calls him the Spirit of Truth. My goodness, if we ever needed the Holy Spirit, we need him now. We need the Spirit of Truth. There's a lot of confusion out there. How do you know? There's so much information. What is true and what is not? You can't figure it out, but the Holy Spirit will point it out because he's the Spirit of Truth. He's earned that title. The world can't receive him. The world isn't interested in him. The world doesn't recognize him, but you do. Because you know him, he dwells with you, and he will be in you. And then he goes on in verse 26 to say, the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things, and he will bring to remembrance all the things that I said to you. Now, this is amazing. Because the reason why you and I have a Bible in our hands is because of the Holy Spirit. You see, back in that day, there was no iPhones. The disciples were not filming Jesus. They were in the moment. So everything that happened, they had to remember. And they remembered because the Holy Spirit downloaded it to them. And the Bible says in 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. Do you know who the inspiration of God is? The Holy Spirit. So this is the cool thing. I want you to hear this. The Holy Spirit helped uneducated men write the Word of God. The Holy Spirit helped them remember and write the Word of God. That same Holy Spirit will help you understand what they wrote. That's good. Did you get that? You see, here's why. He's very personal. The Holy Spirit speaks to you in a way that you need to hear it. He is your tutor. He will help you understand. Let me explain this to you. See, I was in high school. I was a junior in high school. And as a junior, you have to take chemistry. Not my strongest subject. In fact, I was getting a D. I could not understand what this teacher was saying. It was so frustrating. Anybody else have a not love for chemistry? Yeah, okay. So you're with me. You feel my pain. So on top of things, I get pneumonia. I miss over a month of school, and I'm worried. All my other classes, great, but I am going to fail chemistry. This is just going to mess me up. So what do? They get me a tutor. The tutor comes and talks to me, asks me questions. She begins to teach me. She begins to catch me up on all my subjects. I went back to school. I ended up with a B+ in chemistry. Yes, come on. Rock on. I am not that good in chemistry. What's the difference? My personal tutor knew how I need to be taught. She taught me the way I could understand it. How much more will the Holy Spirit teach you the most important things you need to know in a way that you can get it? So what does that mean? I'll tell you what it means. That right now, if you read the Word of God and you don't understand it, if you're bored with the Word, if you feel God is distant, if you don't have peace, if you don't have joy, it's because you are missing the help of the Holy Spirit. Because he's your source. He's our ability. He is our connection with Jesus. He is willing to have this relationship with you. Are you willing to let him lead? And I love this about the Holy Spirit. In every aspect of life, he's here to help us. Remember, he's here to help us with what Jesus said. I'll bring all these things to your remembrance. And he's here to help us with what Jesus is saying. In John 16, verse 13, he says this to us. When the Spirit of truth has come, he will guide you into what? All truth. He's not going to speak of himself on his own authority. No, no, no. Whatever he hears me speaking now, he will say it to you. So not only is Jesus still speaking to the church through the Holy Spirit, he's telling us what Jesus is saying now. And then he also says he's going to tell you things to come. So I love this because last week we talked about, my husband talked about the importance of being new wineskins. And sometimes we hear this terminology in the church and we don't, what does that mean? How do I become a new wineskin? It's through the help of the Holy Spirit. He's the one that will speak to you in a way that you can follow, but you've got to choose it. You see, if you are not hearing what Jesus is saying to you, it's because you need the help of the Holy Spirit. And without the help of the Holy Spirit, you won't know it. You're not supposed to be in the dark when you're supposed to be the light. But the good news is that he's already been working in you. So let's go back to the words of Jesus, because we're going to find in this passage there's three main things that the Holy Spirit wants to focus on in our lives. In John 16, 7, he says, it's best for you that I go away, because when I go, the advocate's going to come. And when he comes, this is what he's going to focus on. He will convict the world of sin, number one, and of God's righteousness, number two, and of the coming judgment. Those three things, sin, righteousness, and judgment. Those are super important to us. So let's unpack those. Number one, he's here to convince you of your sin. See, that's the point, that the Holy Spirit's already been working in your life, because that's the only reason you and I could get saved, because he convinced us that we needed to stop doing the life the way we were doing it. He convinced us that we were sinners because it was true. Now, we can't do that. Did you ever try to do that? Did you ever just like get in somebody's face and say, hey, just want you to know, hey, you're a sinner. You are a sinner. Hey, are you listening to me? You're a sinner. I don't care how you say it. You are either going to get laughed at or punched. Because it's not your job. You can't do that. But the Holy Spirit can go where no man can go. You see, the reason you're saved is because the Holy Spirit spoke to your spirit. You cannot speak to another person's spirit. But what you can do, for those of you that are trying to get loved ones saved, stop it. It's not your job to save. It's the Holy Spirit's job to save. You can't convince, but what you can do is speak the truth in love. You give the Holy Spirit something to work with, and the Holy Spirit uses your words to show them truth. And just like you got saved, it's the same process for them. That's the answer. So the Holy Spirit, not only did he convict you of your sin and convince you of your sin to bring you into salvation, but he wants to continue that relationship. He wants to continue to help us maintain that relationship. See, it's very important that we begin to appreciate this, because remember, he's with us always. And what is his main goal? His main goal is to connect us with Jesus. So why would someone whose goal is to bring us closer to Jesus abandon what he's been sent to do? No, he's never going to stop that. He's always going to be here. You see, the Holy Spirit is sensitive, but he's not fragile. And it's his sensitive nature that is actually the strength that empowers us to be able to connect with us and relate to each and every one of us. So we need to continue to allow him to convince us when we are in sin. Because there's something, a different dynamic that happens in our life with the Holy Spirit and our relationship when we refuse to allow him to tell us about our sin. And we live in a society that's all about comfort. We want squishy insoles in our shoes. We're all about comfort. I mean, really, isn't that silly? We don't like discomfort. And so it's easy for us in our society to come to this place where, even as Christians, we don't want to hear it. Don't judge me. God knows my heart. Yes, he does, and it needs some fixing. So we can grieve the Holy Spirit, and when we do, there's a different dynamic in that relationship. When he's grieved, he doesn't run, but he relates to us differently because his goal is to get us back in right relationship. He wants you to repent. That's why you're feeling uncomfortable, because he knows the relationship you're missing out of. He wants repenting and restoration. That's what he wants. You see, I was the kind of person before I was saved where I was highly insecure and very prideful. That is not a good combination. So if you tried to correct me, I'd be like, uh-uh. And when I got saved, the Lord said to me, Colleen, your only way to growth is for you to be courageous enough to own your junk, to bring all of those things you're hiding into the light. That's the only way you're going to grow. So I realized I needed an about face. I needed a paradigm shift in my thinking. And so this is what I did. I prayed. I said, okay, Lord. So Holy Spirit, I want to embrace every level of conviction you bring to my life. I embrace it. And can I tell you something about a prayer like that? You do not want to pray it casually. Because he will convict you. And there are seasons in my life I feel like, just get off my back. But then, isn't it true that the Holy Spirit is a lot nicer to us correcting us than people? So doesn't it make sense to pray that prayer? That is if your end goal is to be more like Jesus. Otherwise, just pretend I never said this. Number two. Yes, he's here to convince you of your sin, but he is here also to convince you of your relationship, of your righteousness. He wants to tell you, you know what? You've been made holy. You're in right standing with the Father. He does not want you to see yourself as a sinner. You are not a sinner. When you come into the kingdom of God, you are not a sinner anymore. The Bible says in Romans 8:1, there is now no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. There's no longer a legitimate place for condemnation in our life, that we are unacceptable to God. We are now to come before the throne of grace. We come under the blood of Jesus, but you aren't covered and hiding under the blood. You are cleansed by the blood. He can see your face. He wants to see your face. He has made you righteous. And we have a harder time with that sometimes than we do understanding that we sin. This is an important thing. You cannot move past this base to the next one. You need to understand that. You see, there's a lot of us who are insecure, and there's a reason why. It doesn't mean we're weak people. We're insecure because we're missing our identity. So we find ourselves looking for it on selfie posts to see how many likes we get. We're looking for something to be fed that says there's value in our life. And can I tell you that no one can, just like no one can convince you you're a sinner, no human being can convince you that you have a great level of value. That's only the Holy Spirit. And I can't think of any more value in our identity on the face of this earth than to know that we are a son or daughter of the Most High God. And that's what the Holy Spirit will do if you let him, if you let him, if you let him. He's trying to talk to you about this. This is why Romans 8 says you haven't received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. That's not who you are. You were a slave to sin, but now you are no longer a slave. You are a son. You went from slave to son, from slave to daughter. You've received God's spirit. And when that happened, you became a part of the family. You were chosen. You were adopted in. And now you get to call him Abba, Daddy God. You see, Abba is a term of endearment. It's a nickname. Because it's to denote intimacy. This is brand new. And the thing is that as we grow up as adults, sometimes we fail to understand the importance of being a child of God. But Jesus tried to remind us. He said, you know what? Nobody enters the kingdom unless you become like a child. He wants you to know you're not damaged goods. You're precious and cherished. He tells you this over and over again. I call it kind of like the fist pump. Like, yes, I belong to Jesus. Now you're looking at me laughing, saying, that's really corny, but now you're going to do it. Ready? Come on. Ready? Yes, I belong to Jesus. Did you do it, Midtown? I could see you. See, didn't that feel good? Yeah, because he is affirming. It's true. She's not playing you. It's true. You're a child of God. Number three, he wants to convince you of your freedom. Remember, the last thing was the judgment. And so who's being judged? Well, John 16:11 tells us it's the ruler of the world that's judged. He's not talking about you. See, the Holy Spirit has been sent to convince you that Satan's authority over your life is demolished, it's broken, it's finished, finito, no more, no more. And then I'm talking about every aspect of your life. You see, I made an amazing discovery after I got saved. See, before I was saved, I was a smoker. I smoked for a long period of time. I tried to quit, failed, tried to quit, failed. You know the scenario, right? And I get saved, and God delivers me. But it wasn't too long after that that I started dreaming about smoking. You see, the enemy is a coward, but he's very crafty. And so he will sneak into your vulnerable places so that you see yourself doing something and you are convinced of it. He was trying to form that to get that authority back over my life that he once had. Interesting, we have this term, chain smoker. Where does that come from? Because you're under chains, you're under bondage, whether it's pornography, whether it's eating habits. Yes, you can be changed to bad eating habits. And you can be destroying your temple through what you eat, just as I was destroying my temple through what I was doing through smoking. And the Holy Spirit is trying to help you, but you better let him convince you that it's wrong before he can convince you that you're good enough, before he can convince you that he is your way out. You don't need Jenny Craig to tell you that, because she doesn't have that information. So here I am. And then I noticed that I'd be around somebody and I'd light up a cigarette and I'd be like, oh, something in me. It was that spirit of this world trying to draw me back into that habit. And then I'm reading this passage one day. You see, the Holy Spirit is so on time. He takes the word, if you read it, open it up and read it, and he will open up to say, see right here, this is what you need, baby girl, and this is what he did to me. Look at Romans 8. He says, you are not controlled by your sinful nature. That old way, you're not controlled by cigarettes anymore, Colleen. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. And I said, yes, I do have the Spirit of God living in me. I'm not controlled by cigarettes anymore. And he goes on to say, and Christ lives within you. And so even though this body is weak, even though you are subjected to temptation, And even though it's going to die because of sin, guess what? The Spirit gives you life because you have been made right with God. And the Spirit, the same Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead. Jesus is dead. He's in hell. He's really dead. And the Holy Spirit that was powerful enough to come and take a dead Jesus out of hell and raise him up and put him up sitting next to the Father, that same Spirit is in you, baby. That same Spirit. And just as God raised Jesus from the dead, He's going to give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit. You see, whatever area that I'm weak in, wherever your weakness is, He's my strength. You and I have an advantage in this world through this relationship with the Holy Spirit. And all that I just talked about is available to you. But I understand it might not be active in you, but that can change. Whatever it is you're struggling with, whatever it is that you are so broken over and feel so discouraged about, you're not going to get out of it by allowing yourself to be condemned. You have to come into the realization. You have to own your junk and say, yes, what I'm doing is wrong and it's sin. Number two, you have to remember that you are the righteousness of God. You aren't slime on the face of the earth. You're cherished. You are a son or daughter of God. You are valuable. You are important to the kingdom. Your life matters. Everything about you matters to God. Everything about you matters to God. It's just that everything about Him needs to matter to us. That dominion has been broken over you. And now you have a choice. You and I are free to choose how we go forward. See, we can allow the spirit of this world to drive us, or we can allow the Holy Spirit to lead us. It's your choice. And why am I pointing that out? Because see, there was a time when we were used to being deceived and manipulated and tricked by the enemy, and we felt we had no choice. You always did have one, but it sure felt like that because he was in our face. He would drive us to do things, and we were weak against him. And now we enter into this new relationship with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit doesn't treat you the way the devil does. He's not going to drive you. He's not going to push you. He will lead you. But we have to change the way we relate to him. We have to submit. We have to learn how to listen and follow his leading. Romans 8 in verse 5 and 6 says, those who live according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh. What are we talking about? How much are you on your social media? That's the things of the flesh. It's all about your opinion, somebody else's opinion, somebody's stupid cat video. I mean, you know, it's, how helpful is that? But he says, those who live according to the Spirit, they set their minds on the things of the Spirit. So here's what we need to learn to do. I know we don't understand this yet, but this is what we need to learn. We need to learn how to live according to the Spirit. Because if you're carnally minded, it ends in what? Death. But to be spiritually minded is what? Life and peace. Make your choice. Make your choice. Because he's not going to lead you by force. He's going to lead you by the word. So you need to start reading the word. And when you read it, you need to ask the Holy Spirit to teach you. And he will take you up on it. He's going to prompt you, but he won't push you. He comes as a still, small voice. So what does that mean when I talk about the Holy Spirit speaking? He doesn't speak to you audibly. He speaks to you in the form of thoughts that kind of bubble up from the inside. You know, these thoughts that you know didn't come from you. You know, sometimes as we're preaching and we go out in the lobby and some of you come up and go, man, you were speaking right to me. And it was like, no, that wasn't me. That was the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is amazing. You see, if we want to further this relationship with Him, we need to go ahead and jump into the fullest. And we need to learn to lean on Him. We need to be quiet and listen. We need to be more discerning about our diet. I'm talking about what you allow your eyes to see. Your curiosity needs to change. Because He is not processed, you don't process Him intellectually. He speaks to your spirit. He will affect your mind, and He will affect your body. Because you know what He is? He's the source of creativity. When you are walking in the fullness of the Holy Spirit, you get the big ideas. You're the one that shows up on the job with the amazing idea. Those ideas come from the Holy Spirit. He's the one that helps you solve problems. When you're stumped and you can't figure it out, you let the Holy Spirit, you come out of your head and go into your spirit, and He deposits, bam, there it is, the answer. That's what He wants to do. I remember when I got saved and I got filled with the Holy Spirit, and I have an art degree, and I was pretty good in art, and I landed this job. And I remember this freelance job, and I dive into it, and it was like, wow. Like, I just increased, my talent increased exponentially. I knew I wasn't that good. Can I tell you, without seeming to be a fraud, a lot of the things that I say, I am not that good. It's the Holy Spirit. But that's okay. He doesn't mind if we plagiarize His material. In fact, that's the point. He wants you to be His mouthpiece. He wants you to find out there's a whole new level of living this spiritual life with Him where you get to say all this cool stuff and know stuff, and you're like, wow, this is called standing in awe of God. You're supposed to be standing in awe of Him because of what He's doing in you, not just in other people's lives. You're not to be on the sidelines. You're to be on the front line. You're to be salt and light. He doesn't want you to be in darkness when you're supposed to be light. That's why He gave you the Holy Spirit. So what if every single one of us came into this realization that the most important relationship on this earth is with the Holy Spirit? We would make every necessary adjustment in life to allow Him to guide us into all truth, to allow Him to bring all things to our remembrance. He brings the Word of God to remembrance, but He will also show you where you left the car keys. I'm serious. He will show you things to come. Because the church is supposed to lead in this hour. You're supposed to lead because you're the light. The light always goes first. So He wants to show you things to come. If we knew the value of this relationship, we would obey His voice when He speaks. When He tells us, don't say that. Does He talk to you like that? He talks to me a lot like that. Colleen, don't say that. I know you're thinking it. Don't say it. Behave. We would embrace His conviction when we sin. We would appreciate what it really is. We would know His end goal. We would receive His affirmation as son and daughter. We wouldn't try to live without it. We would allow Him to empower us over temptation. Things that used to look good, He will reveal the truth about them, because the devil knows how to package temptation very well. But the Holy Spirit will help you see through. And we would allow Him to lead us and to fill us and to seal us. So I know that right now, everyone's at a different place. And what I'm talking about, what I've just shared with you, may be so foreign to you because you're saying, I don't even know Jesus. See, I realize that there's a lot of you here. You're streaming. you're in Midtown, and you were just like me, just doing life on your own, and you didn't want anybody telling you what to do, and you're making a mistake, how's that working for you? Because it's not. Because you're missing out on something. You see, you don't know what it means to be spiritually alive. Right now, you're spiritually dead. That's why your life is so boring. That's why you keep going after the things that the world tantalizes you with. You're craving something this world cannot satisfy. And it's Jesus. And you need him. And you need to stop messing around and give your life over to him. Now. 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 Because right now he's talking to you. He's doing that thing that I spoke of earlier. He's convincing you that you're in sin and you need to repent. Because there's something waiting for you on his other side. So I want to ask you here in this room, if you're in Midtown, if you need to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you need to stop being so independent and so afraid, and now's your moment, and you say, I want to receive Jesus, I want you to lift your hand up. Don't be shy. Don't be ashamed. Lift up your hand right now. Awesome. Awesome. We're going to enter into this relationship through prayer, and I want you to pray with me and just repeat after me, but make these words yours. Heavenly Father, we acknowledge the voice of your Holy Spirit right now in our life. And we say, we are a sinner, and we need you, Jesus. We repent of our sin, and we ask you, Holy Spirit, to come in. Come into our spirit so that we can be made alive. Cleanse us from all sin and unrighteousness and establish our relationship in the family. We receive you now. And now you've entered in. You've entered into the family of God. In Jesus' name, you're a child of the Most High God. All of that stuff is gone. A new life has come into you. A new life like you never knew before. And so now this journey begins. And you need to keep pursuing him. And you need to get to know him. He's so worth getting to know. I can't think of a better way for us to end our time here than to make a declaration. It's time for us to make some commitments to the Holy Spirit. Would you agree with me? All right, then stand up to your feet. And don't anybody leave, because this is way too important, because I can see you if you leave. Just being mama, okay? All right, we're going to put some words up on the screen, because I want you to see what you're saying, and I want you to make them yours. Let's say this together. Ready? Jesus. Thank you for sending the Holy Spirit. Now say it with me. Ready? Holy Spirit. Say it with me. Together, I'm your helper. Okay, ready? Start all over again. Jesus, thank you for sending the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you are my helper. I desire to have a greater relationship with you. You are the Spirit of truth. I thank you for opening up the Word of God to me and bringing new revelation and understanding. You bring all things to my remembrance, and you show me things to come. I embrace your conviction in my life when I sin. I receive your affirmation that I am a son or daughter of the Most High. I trust in your strength to empower me over temptation into a place of liberty. You have sealed me and you are leading me. I thank you that you are with me always and you will never leave me. From this moment forward, I will honor you and follow you and obey you. Amen. Amen. God bless you.